for local audience. Okay, so we'll be doing that in Mandarin. But we have simultaneous interpretation. 我希望能够介绍 Professor Thongchai Winichakul, but 在这个介绍之前，我们先想昨天所讨论的这个其余的兴起 ，the rest of the West 是吗？还是 the rest of the mainstream 或者是这个 canon？ 当我们在想这个其余，它还有什么？可能是其他的历史、其他的记忆、其他的可能是。被一个政治过程、被一个历史过程所湮灭的一些历史事件。那昨天刘晓莲教授讨论了这个中共的帝国意识形态和它的边疆治理，以至于边疆的族群它经历了几次的强迫的同化，或者是甚至就是清洗。那这些历史其实非常非常多，它都还是没有被记录，没有被讨论，直到了最近几年，它也持续没有被讨论，仍旧在发生。类似的当然不只是像西方这个 Armenia 或者是 Jews， 或者是其他各地持续在90年代以后在发生的，在东亚地区。东北亚、东南亚地区在二战之后，我们所谓的冷战时期，就像是刘晓莲教授所说的这个热战，不管是韩国的济州岛，或者是台湾228，或者是印尼在60年代进500,00050多万的人的死亡，到现在政府都没有认真的去面对。那同样的情形以不同的方式在越南、柬埔寨，或者是在马来西亚，或者是泰国也都发生。那我们就是要问这些被湮灭的记忆、被沉默的记忆，它如何影响了当前的人们的意识形态，或者是感情结构，如何无法去面对和承认。所以这个就是Professor Winichakul 会讨论的 state of denial， 因为他在过去已经有几篇文章在谈泰国政府政治领域之内的两个大项。他是皇室结合军政府吗？还是皇室军政府结合 support 他的那个？那甚至昨天我们讨论过的 ethnocentric nationalism， 它持续在东亚地区还在运作。那这个 ethnocentric nationalism， 其实在Professor Winichakul 过去写的 Sign Map Geobody， 那这是一个以这个被建构的种族性去建构的一个国民或者是民族。那类似的过程也在马来西亚发生，那可能也在台湾或者是中国或者是越南等等，而以至于他们会抵制这个其余的人民。所以那我现在就来正式的介绍 Professor Winichakul。 Thongchai Winichakul 教授他目前任职在日本贸易振兴机构亚洲经济研究所，他过去其实是在 Wisconsin Madison 他的历史学的教授，荣誉退休教授，同时也在泰国的那个法政大学任教。他在2003年被选为美国文理理科学院的这个院士，在新加坡的 RE 担任首席研究员。他获得过多次的学术荣誉，包括了 John SimonGuggenheim Award and Grand Prize for the Asia Pacific Book Award, Association of Asian Studies Chair. 他也长期担任这个Association for Asian Studies 的学会主席、副主席、执行行政员、委员，和94到10年他在 2010年组织的泰国研究学会等等。那他的刚才我所说的 Sign Maps 这本书，它非影响这个非常的广泛，在日文、中文、韩文都有翻译，当然是泰文也有。那其实我认识我知道Professor Winichakul 是几年前我的马来西亚的学生推荐的，他说我们应该要邀请他，那能够了解他多一些关于他对于这 ethnocentric nationalism 或者是说东南亚的政治结构的问题。那这次有这个机会我们邀请的，那我们也会对他进行一些访问，希望能够记录他的一些论点也发表希望能够有更多的流传。那这次他的演讲除了今天之外，下礼拜一在社文所另外一场演讲，就是继续今天会谈论的问题。那那我们现在就欢迎他。Let's welcome Professor Winichakul.
Thank you very much. Let's start.I'm grateful for the organizer of this conference to give me the opportunity to give a talk on this topic. It's a my academic interest, in fact, is about intellectual history, changing of modernity and science. I call it under-colonial modernity, late 19th century to early 20th century. But this subject is a subject that close to my heart.You see, you understand after, I mean, as the talk goes along. This talk is always a subject that I have been working on for 20 years because it is a mission of my life to write about the October 6th massacre in Bangkok. The book manuscript was just done, already released in a year, so this sentence is informational. So I assume that you have read the abstract. I might add.If the race of the, if the rising of the race doesn't mean, does not only mean the race of the West, this is a story of different moments of silence among the rest of the West. In the early hours,Of October 6, 1976, police and paramilitary groups cooperatively surrounded Thammasat University for 4 to 5,000 people have gathered peacefully all night to protest the return of one of the former dictators who were ousted by popular uprising 3 years earlier in 73. So in 76, they planned to return. There was a protest for 5,000.Gathered peacefully. But then, in the morning, October 6, 1976, this happened. It was a tense morning, 2 weeks after two activists were hanged while putting up protesting posters. And only a day after a student skit that reenacted the hanging of the activists was accused by the military propaganda machine for mocking the crown prince in effigy.This crown prince is the current king. Students never had opportunity to expose a false allegation. At 5:30, a rocket propelled bomb was fired into the crowd inside Thammasat. Four were killed instantly and dozens injured. That bomb signaled the beginning of non-stop discharge of military weapons at the protester that lasted for hours. Apart from those who died by gunshot and explosives,More were lynched. A friend of mine was dragged along the soccer field by a piece of cloth around his neck. Six corpses were laid on the ground for a man to make a peace piece of wood into their chest, as if they were sailors as seen in foreign films. After the besieging force has stormed into the campus, the hysteric crowd dragged some students out. Lynching began. One of them was hanged to death. Four more dead bodies were hanged on the trees outside the massacre. Just 2 minutes walk from the Grand Palace. A female student was shot dead. Her body was dragged along the ground, was stripped off. A stake was put on her body, pointing to her private part. It was a mark of her femininity. You don't need the picture. We have a picture, but you don't need this one. On the street nearby, four bodies were piled up and set into flames. These brutal murders and desecration of the bodies took place with public spectacle. Many of them, including young boys, appeared enjoying the display. On that Wednesday morning of October 6, 1976, the death by gunshot might be the least painful and most civilized murder. Up to this day, there was no official or any adequate investigation into the incident. Zero. Unconfirmed and confusing facts, hearsay, and many unanswered questions remain. According to the police, 46 people died, several hundred wounded, missing ones unreported. The police rounded up more than 3,000 and put them in jail. Even though the number of the dead was relatively smaller, comparing to many atrocities and massacres in the modern world history, even comparing to the 2/20 of Taiwan, this is far smaller. The brutality and the dehumanized desecration of dead body made October 6 among the most heinous incidents. The act of killing and the magnitude of her made the incident repulsive. The horrified Wednesday morning was beyond anybody's anticipation, and it remained incomprehensible to many minds. I was one of the 3,000 who were not dead, but arrested from Thammasat and imprisoned for 2 years. At the time of the massacre, I was 19 years old, second year student, about the same as many of you here. Four decades afterward, the most atrocious incident in modern Thai history remained murky in the consciousness of Thai people. During the carnage, news and information about the incident was strictly controlled while the state's propaganda was rampant. Rumors and sensational stories swept across the country. A few decades later, even when political atmosphere was open in the late 80s and 90s, it remained too sensitive a subject to discuss in public. There were many reasons that make the massacre very difficult for Thai society to remember in any meaningful ways. Yet, it is very hard to disregard or to forget it. Many assume that silence means forgetting. A result of suppression or abandoning of memory. In fact, I argue that silence is not necessarily the end of memory. It's definitely not forgetting. It is often the situation when memory cannot find a voice or cannot be articulated comprehensively to others, to a particular community of such memory, or to the public. The key word here is comprehensibility. A memory of an event always a retrospective narrative. But the narrative may make or may not make sense, may sound very odd and hard to believe, may sound silly or insane, may be easily understood or otherwise, may be meaningful or may be incomprehensible, depending on many factors, such as according to dominant views and ideas, according to religious convictions, according to pervasive public view on certain things, according to science, according to the dominant historical ideology. So the facts cannot be denied, but the facts are not clear, murky. Then clouded by all those factors that come to make the memory that put in the narrative comprehensible to the public. That's the moment of silence. That's a moment of unforgetting, hard to express, even though we know that something was there. For example, a simple example today. Victims of sexual assault by powerful men keep silent for years and decades. Not because they forget, but because they are not sure about the reaction from others to their voice and their memory. Moments of silence are the ones when memory cannot find its voice, cannot be spoken out loud, or cannot be apparent due to fears that it might not make sense to the listeners. Silence is the unforgetting, the inability to articulate memory into a comprehensible narrative in public discourse. The witnesses of the atrocity, be they the victim, the perpetrators, the bystanders, or the contemporary observers, were awkward to articulate their memory of the incident in public spheres. For those who spoke out, their memories were difficult for the public and for younger generation to believe. Yet, the photo and more facts gradually emerged to the public over the years. Thai societies were ambivalent about the atrocity. Is to interpret it, I skip that next part to next page. Two main factors contributing to silence. The first is what Carol Clark called chronopolitics of memory. The changing politics that affected memories, both the individual and the collective ones. In the book, I discussed the relationship